Hello everyone. My name is Akash and I'll be presenting this paper about testing distributed systems called Cobra, making transactional key value stores verifiably serializable. The objective of the paper is black box testing of a data store serializability at scale. So the authors are specifically targeting the cloud databases like Cosmos DB, Amazon Aurora, Yugabyte DB, PostgreSQL as well. The question that they're trying to answer for you is whether our key value store is working as we expect it to. The focus is squarely on execution and not the implementation of the system. Serializability means that our transactions are executed sequentially, and it implies basic data integrity and handling failures robustly when our transactions are executing. Most applications out there implicitly assume serializability, and that is why it's important that we know that the key value stores are working as we expect them to. With that, let's move on to the architecture of Cobra. As you can see, Cobra does not interact with the database in any way, except it has a set of history collectors which sit in front of the clients, which merely receive commands from the client, pass them, record those commands, and whatever the database replies with, they record that as well and send those off to the client. All of this history is then sent to a verifier whose only job is to tell you whether whatever history it has received till now, whether that is serializable or not. Which brings us to our core problem, which is that we identify a serialization graph that is generated from our history of client transactions. And we find some version order in it that is acyclic. So if it is acyclic, then we know that whatever we have is serializable. This is difficult in our context because Cobra does not have access to the database's internal ordering at all. It has to consider all possible version orders and test whether any of them yield an acyclic serialization graph. So the first approach that the author mentioned in the paper is the brute force approach. It also serves as a good intuition for what we are trying to do here. So given a transaction history for T1, which involved three transactions, T1, T2, and T3, we build a polygraph from that transaction history. And then we search for an acyclic graph inside of it. A polygraph encodes the uncertainty in the order in our graph. So here we have three transactions, T1, T2, and T3. And we know that T1 has happened before T2. But we have another transaction, T3, for which we do not know when it might have happened. It might have happened before T1 or it might have happened after T2. And that is a set of constraint. So in this case, when we go on to resolve these uncertainty, we consider both the cases where T3 has happened before T1 and T2 has happened after T3. Luckily, in this case, we see that the graph that we are seeing right now is acyclic in nature. So all of these three transaction history say that what we have a serializable order of execution. What if we have more transactions as it happens in real world workloads? The author's specific focus is on the cloud databases and they want to do it at scale. When we move on to that, even if we introduce one more transaction, we see that our problem quickly becomes intractable. The search space has expanded exponentially as our set of constraints and unknown dependencies has grown. In this case, we have just started one more transaction and we've said T1 has happened before T4. But this T3 transaction now has an unknown with this set of transaction as well. So the search space is exponential. And in order to solve, this gives us a very large search problem to find out an acyclic graph. You have to consider all the options. For this, the authors have authors first went with an SMT solver. They encoded all of these constraints and just sent it as an input to the SMT solver, and it would respond with whether whatever was being sent to it was serializable or not. However, due to the very large search space, as we just saw, it can grow exponentially. We do end up generating too many constraints. And the SMT solver, though it has many optimizations, becomes very slow. This does not satisfy the scalability requirement of the system. So we have this large family of graphs, and we need to narrow down our search space so that the SMT solver can quickly do its work. So we progressively reduce our search space, and Cobra has these components in its system where after constructing the polygraph, it does a set of pruning techniques, and only after that does it send the graph back to the SMT solver, which then replies with whatever it has received serializable or not. For this, all of these pruning techniques are domain specific, and Cobra also keeps verifying in rounds to keep the maximum problem size manageable, because the history will keep on coming in. So Cobra has a way to just look at a certain section of the problem size first and then add more transactions to its history again. So after one verification round is complete, whatever graph Cobra has generated while it was being sent here, Cobra reuses it on the next round and adds new nodes and edges to it from the new history it has received. In all of this, I just want to talk about pruning before we get into combining writes. Pruning here is the last step before we send to the SMT solver, and it is run on parallel hardware. If it finds that whatever graph it has gotten at this step, if it finds an edge that generates a cycle, it throws away both the components of the constraint that we are looking at, and it adds all the other edges to the graph. So pictorially, if it finds that a cycle is being generated somewhere here, so whatever the constraint it is seeing, it will throw away both the constraints, and then whatever is left of it, it will try to add it to the graph and see whether a cycle is being generated again. With that, let's get into the first component of the verifier, which is when we are combining writes. For this one, Cobra is exploiting the read, modify, write pattern that is very common in the real world applications like e-commerce. You are decrementing stock of an item. So looking at this, we have a write, W1, and immediately after that, we have a read and a write. On the similar lines, we have these set of transactions as well, where W3 has happened, and then after W3, and R4 and W4 have happened. So Cobra knows in this context which write transaction has happened before the beginning of this read, modify, write transaction. So here Cobra knows that before R2, W2, W1 has happened, and before R4, W4, W3 has happened. So it will chain both of these transactions together and all the other transactions like these after this. In this particular case, we see that we had four transactions earlier, and there were about four constraints between them. After linking up both of them, we only have one constraint between the two transactions because they have been linked together. So again, our search space has reduced for us. The next technique that Cobra employs is coalescing constraints. And again, this exploits the fact that real world applications have far more reads than writes. So whatever reads have been done after one particular write, so in this case, R3 and R4 have happened after W1, Cobra will combine these reads with this write. And similarly for W2 and R5, this will be another chain. So this is a bit similar to the read, modify, write pattern that we were seeing earlier, except nothing is getting modified here. So we again have two chains, two independent chains, and we only have one constraint between them. Looking back to the verification components, we have gone over combining writes, coalescing constraints, and pruning. This is the pruning part that is done on parallel hardware. Before it is being sent to the SMT solver, Cobra regularly garbage collects all the transactions. So in this case, garbage collection means that whatever transactions are no longer applicable in our current graph, Cobra will discard them, because we don't need one more transaction to increase our constraints in the system. For this, Cobra employs fence transactions. Fence transactions are issued periodically by the clients to create epoch boundaries. So they read and write a single key named epoch. So whatever has happened between those two epochs can be grouped together. The verifier adds these session order edges to the graph. So each of these fence transactions are issued in one particular session. So that is why the verifier is able to do that. It also assigns epoch number to each transaction. So it traverses the graph, locates all the fence transactions that have happened, and chains them due to the read, modify, write property that we saw here for this epoch key. The verifier also keeps track of the largest epoch number that has been seen by every session, every active session, and that is termed as epoch agree. It gives us the guarantee that whatever for a transaction I whose epoch number may be less than equal to whatever the agreed upon epoch is subtracted by 2 right now. And for any future transactions whose epoch may be greater than the agreed upon epoch right now, whatever graph we have will contain a path between those two transactions. So after we have this garbage collection set up for us, we have all the data, we need to identify whatever safe transactions are out there in our graph that can be deleted. So for that, the verifier clones the whole graph and it deletes all transactions that are superseded. Here, superseded transactions mean all the transactions that contain the most recent writes to a key, and they must belong to a previous epoch, not the current agreed upon epoch, a previous epoch. And these superseded transactions must not belong to any cycles in the graph. Or they can belong to a cycle, but that cycle can only consist of superseded transactions. So in case all of them are superseded transactions, the whole cycle can be deleted safely. So we are done with all the components of the verifier. Let's take a look at the evaluation next of how Cobra has performed on some real world workloads. First, Cobra's performance was tested on previously reported anomalies, which were mostly reported by Jepsen. These figures show that Cobra was able to terminate in a very reasonable amount of time while detecting the violations that Jepsen also detected. The next graph compares Cobra's performance against the simple monosat solver on 10K transactions with 8 operations per transaction and 24 concurrent clients. As we can expect, due to the pruning capabilities of Cobra, it vastly outperforms the monosat solver. The reduction in problem space size really helps it. The next graph, we are looking at where does Cobra spend most of its time while verifying serializability. So as we just saw, Cobra constructs the graph, then prunes the graph, and then sends it to the SMT solver. So in this figure, we know according to the workload where Cobra has spent most of its time. All of these workloads are for 10K transactions again. As we can observe that the pruning phase dominates for high read workloads. Cobra is able to easily prune up all of that search space for us, while solving has dominated for high write workloads. In this case, these are all random write workloads. The pruning techniques mostly bundle up the read workloads again and hence dominate benchmarks with many reads like we see here. One particular exception that I found was this benchmark, TPCC, and the author stated that it is very fast because all transactions are mostly read, modify, write, and thus they can be coalesced into a single ordered chain. The authors have particularly emphasized on scaling, and in this figure we see the verification throughput on two of the benchmarks. This benchmark was run on RocksDB again with 24 concurrent clients. The paper does not depict the results for the Twitter and TPCC benchmark, although it does say that it has similar results to CRubis. It also mentions that benchmarks for 50% and 90% write workloads ran out of memory. They mentioned that blind writes limit Cobra's garbage collection ability, and thus whatever pruning techniques they employ, they cannot benefit from that. We discussed about fence frequency before this, and this figure tells us what's the effect of fence frequency on the number of transactions. The Cobra verifier has better throughput if fence transactions are issued more frequently. If you see here, number of transactions between fences for each client. This can be due to the smaller epoch sizes. Smaller epoch sizes allows all the transactions to be GC'd earlier, and thus our problem space is reduced. Fence transactions, if you remember, they also introduce session ordering. So all of those ordering constraints further prune our search space. However, all of these, like if fence frequency is high, these do sacrifice client throughput due to resource contention. There are a couple of limitations with the current Cobra system. There is no guaranteed termination. Worst case, running time is at best exponential for the blind writes because the pruning techniques cannot be taken advantage of. Verifier and collectors that we saw in the system, they are assumed to operate fault-free for now. Cobra only supports a key-value API. the authors have stressed upon that. It does not support range queries, sum, and joins. It also does not support async IO patterns in clients, since client issue operations to the database through sessions, and those spends transactions are also issued in sessions. With that, we come to the end of my presentation. Thank you.